Docentes, rectores, directivos que están acá acompañándonos en EAFIT y a los que nos están viendo a través del streaming, muchas gracias por esperarnos. A esta conferencia o pequeña charla que vamos a tener con el doctor John Cao. Mr. Cao ha sido reconocido como el señor creatividad y ha trabajado en diferentes instituciones educativas asesorándolas en el tema de la innovación y la educación, en cómo la innovación puede transformar esos procesos educativos y cómo se puede cambiar la visión en que nosotros podemos desarrollar actividades dentro del aula y dentro de la institución educativa para lograr que los jóvenes, los niños y los adolescentes desarrollen estas habilidades de creatividad y de emprendimiento. Él ha trabajado en universidades como Harvard y ha asesorado a varios gobiernos en el desarrollo de estrategias educativas como el de Singapur, por ejemplo. Tenemos hoy el privilegio de tenerlo acá en el marco del evento de Heroes Fest y donde una alianza que hemos hecho con Fundación Telefónica, donde yo pertenezco, Empresarios por la Educación, con Ed Bogotá y la alianza con otras instituciones como EAFIT, hemos tenido la oportunidad de poderlo tener acá. Entonces, muchísimas gracias nuevamente por estar acá. Las preguntas van a ser después de que termine la presentación del señor Cao y esperamos que todos ustedes estén muy contentos de que él esté acá. Muchísimas gracias y thank you very much, John.
So, good afternoon. Thank you for coming. I hope that we're going to have a good discussion. I plan to just speak for maybe 15 minutes or so, but I'm sure we will have plenty of things to talk about. I have been working in the innovation field, broadly defined, for about 30 years. I created the innovation curriculum at Harvard Business School, and I was a professor there from 1982 to 1996, 14 years. I've done academic teaching at Stanford University, the MIT Media Lab, the U.S. Naval Postgraduate School, for many companies and for many countries. I've taught in the Singapore Civil Service College, blah, 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 blah. So I've done a lot of teaching because I believe that helping people to learn about innovation and learn about innovation correctly is probably one of the most important things that I can contribute. Innovation is one of the most often used and poorly understood words in any language, Spanish, English, etc. And I've seen the good, the bad, and the ugly of innovation. I've advised countries on national strategy. I actually came to Colombia for the first time 7 years ago and worked with Francisco Santos on what became Colombia 2025. So I've been watching you guys for a long time as you've been engaging with the innovation subject. But I've started companies, I've produced movies, I've produced Broadway theater, I was a professional musician, I was a doctor, I trained in medicine, I trained in psychiatry, I got an MBA, I've been a consultant, I've done a lot of different things. And to me, that's what is necessary to really have a deep understanding of innovation, right? There are a lot of people out there talking about innovation now, right? And it's very, very important to be clear about what it is and how you do it. So to me, the main reason that innovation is important is because, for example, countries like Colombia, cities like Medellin, are talking about innovation. You want innovation. Well, if you want innovation, you need people who know how to do innovation. And if you want people who know how to do innovation, you need to help them learn how to do it. it's not efficient to just have people learn out there in the real world. But then that begs the question of what is a good way to learn about innovation. And to me, innovation is not an academic subject. It's not a theoretical subject. I mean, I can talk theory with anybody, but to me, it's very practical. It really has to do with action, with doing things, with making things happen in the world. So that's why some people call me an innovation activist, because I spend time helping people, entrepreneurs, government officials, et cetera, who want to do innovation, to help them do it and do it better, right? But that also means that the education institutions have a very important role to play in cultivating innovation. And that's why I'm excited to speak with you, because obviously you are engaged with this subject. And a lot of what I've been doing over the last year and a half has been developing a new learning system for innovation and for related fields, I'll explain that later, that is focused right now primarily on middle and high school, but also fits with the university and professional school environment and with continuing corporate education. That's my attempt to create what I think of as being a relevant and useful approach to learning innovation. So I want to share some of that with you. So you know a lot about me now. I don't know much about you. What I want to find out, first of all, is how many of you are working in a high school or middle school now? So about half of you. And of keep your hands up. Of those, how many of you are teachers? So all of the ones from high schools are teachers. How about, are there principals of schools? So who's a principal? Wow, okay. I have to be very polite now. And then who are the other people in the room who are not associated with high schools or middle schools, just so I can understand a little bit about who's in the room? Yeah, so can you just say a word about where you, what kind of work you're doing? Are you in the government? Are you in the mayor's office? Are you researchers? Are you, I don't know, entrepreneurs? Who are you? Maybe just call out.
Consultant.
Government? Government researcher, okay. And others? Educational content development? Okay, virtual content. Great. Mechanical engineering, okay. 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 Anybody else from government that we haven't identified? And where are you? No habla español. State government. But doing what? What are you doing in state government? Huh? Okay. Okay, that's fine. Okay, so now I have to be extra polite. Okay. So let me explain my perspective on innovation, or a couple of perspectives. One is that it's actually pretty straightforward what innovation is. Innovation is creativity, which everybody has. Everybody is creative, applied to some purpose to generate value. It has to be valuable for somebody, whether it's money value or social value or personal value. Okay? Creativity applied to a purpose to realize value. That's innovation, right? And innovation is not a mood. It's not a culture. It's not a belief. It's not any of those things. It's hard capabilities. So let me give you an example. You know, let's say I make a new friend here, and I say to you, I'm a musician, right? I say, you're gonna work with me after this meeting, and you're going to give a jazz piano concert. We're going to move a nice piano here, and everybody's going to stay, and we're going to applaud. I'm going to say to you, you can do it. You're smart. You can do it. I believe in you. We're going to show you where in the, you know, Medellin value system it's important to be innovative, and you can do it. And what's my point? My point is that unless he's been practicing in secret for 10 years, he's not going to be able to do it, right? All of the stuff around encouragement and culture and values and campaigns and communication, that's what I call the hand waving. It's very important, but it doesn't get innovation done. What gets innovation done is developing hard capabilities through practice that allow you to do things that you couldn't do before. And I like to ask leaders often, well, you say innovation's important. What are the capabilities that you want to develop in your organization, in your country, in your people? And very often they can't answer the question because all they've been doing is encouraging people and telling them it's important, very important, okay? So my approach is to say it's about developing hard, objective capabilities, like practicing the piano for 10 years and practicing scales until you can play. Okay? So that's really an important point to me. The other point I want to make is that there's a tremendous amount of confusion about what innovation is because of intellectual politics. So if you think about where innovation comes from, it comes from the field of industrial psychology and management science, right? So you had factories, you had to figure out how to make the factories work more efficiently, you had quality control, TQM, Kaizen. There's a whole culture of industrial innovation. But then you think about the field of creativity. Creativity comes from psychology. So there's the lateral thinking, brainstorming, all these kind of psychology-oriented people. Then there's design, and now design thinking, right, which is the biggest fad right now, in intellectual fad. Well, design arose as a field because people had to develop new products, and they wanted to make the products nice so that people would buy them. So design became a way of increasing consumption because something looked nice, or it smelled nice, or it came in a nice box, right? And then designers said, we're not getting paid enough. We want to take our knowledge of design and apply them to social problems and to business problems and strategy problems because we'll get paid more. So design thinking is a recent evolution of design, which is about taking these techniques that originated in product development, which are ethnography, prototyping, scenario of customers, et cetera, and applying them in a larger area. And I'm a big fan of design thinking. I think it's a great field. But it's important to know where these things are coming from. Then there's entrepreneurship, right? Entrepreneurship is really nothing more or less as a field than the study of entrepreneurs. Right, so Steve Jobs, Richard Branson, right, or people who were successful, but maybe they failed. They became unsuccessful, right? So you think about all of these different streams, and it's confusing out there in the intellectual market, because you know people come to you and they say, oh, you should have a course in design thinking. That's really important 21st century skill. Oh, you should have a course on innovation. You should have a course on entrepreneurship. As if these are separate fields. They're not. They're not. They're all about the same thing. At its heart, we talk about generating ideas, developing ideas, and harvesting or realizing the value from ideas. That's it. That's innovation. That's entrepreneurship. Creativity is about the generation of ideas. Design thinking is about all of this as well. So it's the same conceptual map, but it comes from different guilds, different intellectual silos, different traditions. And that's why there's so much confusion around what is going on. There's a country, I won't mention which country, last year they had the year of innovation. And then the year before that, they had the year of entrepreneurship. Two different government ministries, two different silos, no discussion between them. I mean, that's how ridiculous it gets, all right? So hopefully this already kind of gives you a little bit more of a critical sense of, you know, what innovation is, and also how it relates to all of these other words and offerings that are out there, right? Because Colombia is now in a situation where it's going to get very popular, because many people are going to come and say, oh, Colombia wants to have an innovation strategy. You know, here's our design thinking curriculum. Here's our entrepreneurship curriculum. It's not this entrepreneurship flavor that's good. It's lean startup. That's really good, right? And what you have to do is kind of develop a critical sense of what is out there and what's being offered to you, okay? So you're getting my somewhat cynical perspective of 30 years, but hopefully it's helpful to you. Now, for the last year and about 3 months, so let's say the last 15 months, I've been working on a new project, which is called EdgeMakers. EdgeMakers is a new learning system which combines curriculum, digital elements, and other elements to create a holistic learning system that is being focused right now on middle school and high school students. So roughly kids from the ages of 11 to 16, right? And we have been quite successful in attracting interest to EdgeMakers. We have a launch in New York in September. We have a launch in Brazil in January. And we're here in Colombia to talk with municipal governments, the Federal Ministry of Education, corporate partners and allies about whether it makes sense to think about launching EdgeMakers in Colombia in January, this January. Right? So let me talk a little bit about EdgeMakers, and then I'm almost done, but I want to kind of give you the full picture. So, you know, this is hopefully not the way your school looks, but it's still the way a lot of schools look, most schools probably in the world. And there's this old saying that, you know, if a doctor from 100 years ago visited a hospital today, they would not know what was going on. They wouldn't have a clue. I mean, I went to medical school quite a while ago, but not so long ago, not 100 years ago, and I don't know what's going on. You know, there's all this new stuff. But if a teacher from 100 years ago came to a classroom today, they would probably feel right at home, because, you know, you've got desks, you've got books, you've got tests, you've got a teacher whose job is classroom management, and the job of the student is to take in knowledge and be able to spit it out on tests so they can get a score, so they can go to the best university and be measured. It's the industrial factory model of education. And it had its logic, right? But if you think about what young people need in the 21st century, which is now 14% finished, by the way, so we're moving rapidly, the kind of knowledge and skills that was very useful in the industrial age, when modern education appeared in the 19th century, is not so useful in the 21st century. And education's not doing so well. So in the United States, which spends more per student than any other country in the world, over 20% of high school age students drop out of high school and don't finish. In Latin America, I'm told it's higher. Let's just leave it at that. So this is like saying you have a service business and your customers reject your service. And in fact, if it wasn't for the fact that the police or the social agencies would come to your house if you weren't going to school, probably more kids would drop out, right? So there's something about the fit between the customers and the service that isn't working so well anymore. And one of my friends, Grant Wiggins, how many of you know Grant Wiggins, his name? He's the father of something called Understanding by Design, which is one of the best curriculum design systems. Anyway, he said, we lose the kids at age 12 or 13. By middle school, a lot of kids they're not interested in school anymore. That's it. Then there's the question of employability. You know, I mean, companies are not happy with the quality of the people they're getting as young entrants into their organizations. Which is why, you know, for instance, in the US, even though there's a very high unemployment problem, there's a huge number of jobs that are unfilled because they can't find qualified people. And of course, you know, like in Spain, for instance, the youth unemployment rate is over 50%. This is probably one of the biggest societal problems that Spain faces. It's not a problem that causes pain in the immediate term, but it's definitely a huge kind of problem. So it's an important issue to try to think through what education needs to be. The other thing, of course, is that young people are changing. They're different. You know, you have 72% of high school students in the US want to start their own company. That's pretty amazing, right? And 80% of high school students are worried about the condition of the planet. So millennial generation kids, you know, they are kind of, I want to make money, I want to be like Mark Zuckerberg. You know Mark Zuckerberg, right? Huh? Yeah, the Facebook multi-billionaire. You know, Facebook's now worth $190 billion. I won't even start, don't get me started. But but the generation today that is right ahead of the high school age kids, Generation Z, they call it, very concerned about the state of the planet, and also what we're calling generation edge makers, which are these kind of 11, 12 through 16-year-old kids. So I think there's a divide, there's a gap between what students are getting today in school and what they need to know to survive in the 21st century, right? And that's the problem that I decided I would spend some time trying to address. So that brings us to EdgeMakers. So EdgeMakers is an initiative that is about trying to empower young people everywhere to innovate and to make a positive impact on the world. And the idea is to provide this generation of innovators with the tools to make their lives, their communities, and the whole world a better place. Right? So it's not just abstract, let's learn about innovation. Let's learn about innovation for a reason. A lot of the initial thinking of about EdgeMakers was really a direct arbitrage, an import from the 14 years I taught at Harvard Business School. I developed a very successful course at Harvard where 2,000 MBA students took it between 1982 and 1995, which was, you know, basically the definition of a hit course there. And so the lineage of EdgeMakers comes from that time at Harvard Business School. You probably have a lot of questions about the curriculum. Let me show you a short video that kind of goes through what the curriculum is all about. And hopefully the audio is working. If not, the audio's not working. So let's see, which one of these microphones is the, which one of them? I just need a microphone.
Okay.
Do you have, I mean, is this a microphone? Is it on? Can we turn this on?
So we can turn the sound here.
Oh, you can turn the sound on?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Perfect. Okay, here we go.
The core EdgeMaking curriculum consists of 6 courses. They are, first, creativity and innovation. Second, design thinking. Third, entrepreneurs and startups. Fourth, digital literacy. Fifth, character. Sixth, sustainability. The first 4 of these courses are about how. EdgeMaking is a fundamental process of generating an idea, developing it, and realizing value. We call these 3 phases plant, grow, and harvest. They are common to each of our how domains. What distinguishes them are their methodologies. What we call the EdgeMakers toolbox integrates them into a unified whole. Our creativity and innovation course looks at techniques for ideation and ways to combine talent, resources, and ideas within organizations in order to produce value. Design thinking emerged from the discipline of product development to yield a rich assortment of tools, customer insight, ethnographic methods, visual facilitation, prototyping, facilitation, and more. Entrepreneurship as a field coalesced around the experience of startups and their leaders. Successful entrepreneurs understand the specifics of defining an opportunity, marshaling resources, assembling teams, generating and protecting intellectual property, and other pragmatic agendas. And digital literacy changes the landscape for collaboration and co-creation of ideas, as well as providing new ways in which they can be scaled and distributed through the new language of social media. Our fifth course, Character, is about who, the person who is going to do the work of edge-making and the wellsprings of their personal effectiveness. And finally, our sixth course, Sustainability, is the what of our curriculum. What purpose are we going to serve with our new edge-making tools and knowledge? We have chosen sustainability as a pervasive societal challenge to which our edge-maker toolbox can be applied in the interest of enhanced learning.
So basically, we have four course themes that are how you do things: creativity and innovation, design thinking, entrepreneurship, and digital. We have one course that's about who, which is character, which is self-understanding, basically. And then one course stream, which is about what. Like, what are you going to do with these tools? And the curriculum is very much organized around project-based learning. So we have many different challenges that come from the problems of society. So it's sustainability is our choice, but we're also considering developing a set of challenges around innovation and peace, which is not irrelevant for Columbia, and there are other possibilities as well. And just to, so you understand, right now, EdgeMakers is 150 lessons. It's designed to be 1 hour per week for 6 years. So it's designed to be easy to fit into an existing school environment without the school having to change anything. And obviously, these 150 lessons can be organized in many different ways: shorter courses, different kind of schedules, because every country has a different system. And we are, as I said, launching in Brazil. We have a launch in the US. We're talking with Colombia. We have discussions going on in Turkey and India and a number of other places. So we have to have a flexible curriculum, and the curriculum will grow. This is what we've been able to do over the last 7 or 8 months, which is actually, for those of you that have developed courses, it's a lot of curriculum development. We base the curriculum around a set of characteristics or virtues. The old virtues, these are from Boy Scouts, right? And they talked about the importance of being clean and obedient and cheerful and reverent. Those are nice characteristics, but they're not so relevant in the 21st century. So we've developed our own set of character strengths. And sorry, you can't see it in the back, but curiosity, innovativeness, purposefulness, resilience, collaboration, these would be some of them. And the other point is, these exist on a spectrum. So for example, curiosity, sometimes you want to be very experimental and open, and sometimes more skeptical. So the whole idea of these character strengths as having these creative tensions means that we're trying to develop judgment and wisdom, not to have our students have a cookbook from which they can just blindly apply principles. Now, we designed the curriculum in two formats, one of which is no digital at all, because we know a lot of schools really don't have infrastructure for digital or digital school stuff. But we've also designed it to be very digital and friendly. We have mobile apps. We have a teaching platform where teachers basically can do the work of a classroom with almost like an interactive script where they basically click on icons and here's the video, here are the questions, here's the background. And teacher development for us is organized in two levels. Level one is we believe that any teacher who likes the curriculum and is motivated to teach it can learn the basics of how to deliver a great experience in one day. And so we have a one-day training. We have online resources for teacher support and tele-support. The second level, after a teacher has taught it, and assuming they're still excited about it, is we will be having master classes where we can actually get teachers much more deeply into some of the new skills of coaching and facilitation and being a catalyst, which are at the heart of what we believe is the education, the job of being an educator, not just for edge makers, but generally speaking. Okay. So let me show you a little bit about our platform. So imagine that the platform is something that students can use, teachers can use, teams can use, teachers can use it to assign tasks to students, students can use it to communicate with other students, and you can actually establish a situation, for example, where a class in Medellin would be collaborating with a class in London or a class in New York around a specific set of assignments. So let me show you this now. So we asked, there's a class activity, and then after the class, they're asked to log in to the website. And you see the metaphor is tiles. It's a work area. So in this case, the class is about the moon landing. It could be about anything. One of these tiles has videos, it has JPEGs, it has documents, it has questionnaires, it has other interactive elements, and they can be moved around just, you know, by dragging them around. So here you see a film, and then you have a comment block, so you might type in your comment. So let's say the teacher says to the students, okay, tell me what you think about X, and then everybody has to answer. Then the teacher gets all of those responses, right? Now, here's a little bit of reading material that is related to this. You can then use a lot of tools that are related to our platform. Imagine that it's like a big whiteboard with all of the visual tools that you might like. So for example, here's the menu of tools on the left, right? And these are post-it notes. You can drag the post-it notes, type notes on top of them, right? A sticky note. You just fill it out. And you can annotate other people's work. They can annotate your work. So it's a very powerful and simple and easy and enjoyable, I would say, interface to use and highly collaborative. And then the other thing is that it can also facilitate metrics. So you can actually measure how active somebody is in the digital environment, how much comments they receive from other people, how many comments they make of others, et cetera. So, you know, in summary, we got a school curriculum. We also have a pathway for schools to become more and more like edge schools. So beyond the one class per week, there are other ways that schools can add to the curriculum or add to their tool set. We have a website, we have challenges, we have a world-class design and assessment team, digital, global, mobile, and also platforms for teachers. So we believe that, you know, the response to EdgeMakers on the part of students has been overwhelming. I mean, every place we go, the students basically say, we want it now. We believe that there's a similar movement that's going to happen with teachers. Not all teachers, but every school is going to have some teachers that are going to say, wow, I would like to learn about this, I would like to teach this. And we are going to organize those teachers worldwide as a community using social media and using web platforms. So, I think I'll skip that. I think, oh, okay, so this might be interesting for you. This is a view of teachers and school owners in Brazil. We did a big pilot in Brazil recently. And by the way, the video of the curriculum showed a lot of Brazilian students from the pilots we did. We've done pilots for about 1,000 students around the world as we've been developing the curriculum.
Thank you. palestra do professor Keo, porque realmente representa uma alternativa, um auxílio nos desafios que os educadores de hoje têm a vencer.
Pensar num currículo novo para a educação brasileira, na minha opinião, é pensar também num currículo novo para o futuro.
É algo que a gente tem que sensibilizar as escolas para essa nova opção, essa nova forma de educar e do real objetivo da educação, né? Saindo da perspectiva apenas vestibular e indo realmente para o mundo, para a transformação e para realmente mudar o mundo.
Para nós foi uma experiência incrível participarmos e recebermos a Edmake no nosso colégio. Os alunos ficaram muito empolgados, muito felizes, nos pergunta toda hora quando teremos de novo.
É bacana porque quando você joga os problemas que foram jogados no projeto da Edmakers, eles conseguem perceber que eles são capazes de resolver apenas com as ferramentas que são dadas, que é a criatividade.
Acho que elas puderam colocar em prática essa vontade de criar e realmente resolver o desafio que foi colocado para elas.
So we think that EdgeMakers could be what we call an education solution for Columbia as it looks at how to innovate education but also educate for innovation. So I'm happy to take any questions or comments about either part of what I've shared, either innovate the field of innovation or about EdgeMakers. And we're very serious about trying to figure out a plan for bringing it here. Hopefully that sounds like a good idea to you, not a bad idea. But I'd like to get your questions. Yeah, he has to hear you in the back, so we need to use the microphone.
Buenas tardes. Buenas tardes. El programa requiere necesariamente de conectividad a una red porque hay sitios de pronto.
Okay, wait a second. It's not working. It's well, I had it on all of them. Should I be number one? Sorry, one second. Frequency.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. All right. No wonder it was making noise. Okay. Okay, good. Got it. Sorry. Go ahead.
Okay. Te preguntaba que si EdgeMakers requiere necesariamente de estar constantemente conectado a Internet, debido también a que en muchos sitios pues, de nuestra geografía, por la constitución de ella, a veces no hay acceso. ¿Hay alguna manera de realizarlo sin que se requiera conectividad constantemente?
Okay, so I think I heard the question. We have two versions of the curriculum. One involves no computers and no internet. It's digital free, totally analog. And then the other is more digital. Because we don't want this to be just for, schools that are at the top of the pyramid and that can afford technology. We want it to be for all schools. We want this to be a national solution. So we have a version that works with no technology.
Turn up the volume because you can't control the volume.
I know, except every time I do that, it crackles. And
it's probably because you have too many guidance.
I wonder why. Okay, let's go.
Yeah, so I'm actually going to say the question in English. So my question is, I feel like sometimes, or not sometimes, but always, the biggest enemy of innovation in general and this type of education is institutions themselves. Mm-hmm. Because they have a lot of bureaucracy and they cannot evolve as fast as these yep. methods do. So how can you make a method that you can go as fast as the methods and the world are evolving, while the institutions and all the bureaucracy that you have to follow go way slower than they do?
Well,
La pregunta que estoy haciendo es que el mayor enemigo de la innovación en general son las instituciones mismas por toda la burocracia que ellas manejan, porque el mundo y estos tipos de métodos van evolucionando a una rapidez constante, exagerada, y las instituciones con toda la burocracia que tienen no pueden alcanzar el mismo nivel de rapidez. Entonces, ¿qué método ellos tienen para poder ir al ritmo de la innovación?
Okay, so, you know, you're asking me, and I'm not an all-powerful human being, so I can't change education, right? Education is going to change partly because the world is changing. So I think that as, well, I'll say this. So, you know, here you have students, right? And here you have the world of learning opportunities. And in the middle, you have education institutions. And what's going on now is disintermediation, meaning the connection between the end user and the thing they want to use is direct, more direct. So like Khan Academy, for instance, is a simple example. So it's possible that a certain element of school is going to become like Blockbuster Video. It's just in the value chain, it's going to be less and less critical as the internet and other forms of learning become more important. Now, I'm not anti-school, so I don't want to scare you. I think that what we have decided to do is not to try to come into conflict with schools. We want to be the best friend of schools. We want to be the vitamin pill that makes schools work better, right? We want to bring the things and help them easily to do it where they couldn't do it before. And we think that our message is going to, like a virus, begin to affect the way that schools function. But it's going to take time. You know, how do any established institutions change? They change because their business model falls away. You know, I mean, if 50% of students drop out of school, you know, that's going to be a big problem. Right now, I understand in some parts of Latin America, it's 40%, so it's pretty unbelievable to begin with, right? So, you know, I like to think about change management in schools, not like a frontal assault, you know, that's usually how you get killed, but going around to the side. I mean, that's in terms of the edge maker's strategy.
An example that you made about Brazil, which has, I guess, like a similar kind of institution as we do. Do you feel kind of like a welcoming, or you feel like kind of an obstacle in the sense that you try to go put the pace and they lag a bit, or like how you felt?
It's welcoming. I mean, but it's welcoming because we have a. You have to ask the question in Spanish.
La pregunta que le dice es que si en Brasil él se sintió, que es una institución muy similar a la de nosotros, y él se sintió bienvenido, y si las instituciones pudieron ir al ritmo en el que él se movía, o si de pronto eran un poco más lentos o más resilientes, pues como al cambio.
So, just give me the one-liner in English again. The question is.
So the question is in Brazil.
Oh yeah, is it? Yeah, so in Brazil, I mean, we're talking with major corporations about sponsoring large numbers of students. The former president of Brazil, Fernando Henrique Cardoso, I'm meeting with him in 3 weeks to talk about getting his support to launch this there. Everybody sees the value of it. It's important. And the kids are very, well, you saw the kids, you know, in these videos. They, you know, they love it. So implementation is obviously always a challenge. It would be a challenge here, but you know, that's part of our responsibility. So anybody have a question? Okay, and then there's here, and then there's one way in the back there.
Buenas tardes, yo soy rector de una institución educativa y recientemente...
Okay. That microphone is not getting me back, it's not good, so I'm going to talk to him.
Buenas tardes, soy rector de una institución educativa. Acabamos de terminar un primer proceso rectores y líderes transformadores y estamos en la aventura de aplicar la innovación educativa en nuestras instituciones. Quisiera preguntarle, doctor John, ¿qué obstáculos ha encontrado usted cuando ha tenido un público como el de nosotros, instituciones educativas, en la implementación de las estrategias de innovación? ¿Qué oposición o qué problemas ha encontrado usted que nos pudiera servir a nosotros para la implementación de experiencias innovadoras?
In what kind of organizations is he talking
about? ¿Qué tipo de organización?
Instituto educativo de secundaria.
It is in a high school.
General.
High school.
Yeah, high school.
Well, I think the obstacles are, number one, we don't need to change. Right.
Okay. Yo primero que todo pienso es que nosotros no necesitamos cambiar.
So, you know, the costs of changing seem much higher than the comfort of not changing.
El costo de cambiar parece mucho más alto que el costo de no cambiar.
Then there's a regulation.
Y después están las regulaciones.
There's a nostalgia for the traditional model.
Hay una nostalgia por el modo tradicional en que
which
se hacen las cosas.
Which is often sometimes quite authoritarian, you know, sort of top down.
Que a veces es muy autoritario, que trabaja de arriba hacia abajo.
There's shortage of time, so you don't feel like you have time to learn a new way of teaching, a new subject.
Sí, es falta tiempo para enseñar nuevas cosas, nuevos temas.
And there's no story, you know, it doesn't fit with any need that society feels.
Y no hay una historia y no encaja dentro de las necesidades que nosotros sentimos que la sociedad necesita.
And then, of course, there's money. You know, if there's no money to pay for new stuff, then it's not going to happen.
Del dinero, porque si no hay dinero para pagarle al personal, no van a suceder las cosas.
So, I mean, that isn't that enough?
¿No es eso suficientes problemas con los cuales no se podemos encontrar?
I'm depressed already.
Ya me deprimí. Me pasa el que están con el que están haciendo el streaming y yo lo tengo acá. Por favor, so that way they can hear. This is for the streaming.
Got it.
Sorry, but
no, it's fine.
I have a problem here with the hookups.
Don't worry.
Otra pregunta, por favor.
Acá. Buenas tardes. La pregunta que tenemos.
The question that we have back here,
¿cómo podrían los rectores de cada una de las instituciones educativas contribuir a ese modelo de cambio que está proponiendo usted?
To that model of change that you are proposing. How can we contribute to that change?
To edge makers.
Y además
hacia,
de eso,
¿hacia edge makers o a la innovación en general?
Hacia Edgemaker, digámoslo así, instaurado en las instituciones educativas. Y además de eso, ¿qué competencias? Es muy difícil.
I love this question. There's more?
¿Y qué competencias debería tener un rector y los educadores que forman parte de las instituciones educativas para liderar ese modelo de Edgemakers en las instituciones educativas?
To be in control of that empowerment.
Right. So I like that question very much.
Tu pregunta mucho.
We actually, you're not the first person to ask this question. And one of our plans is to establish an Edge Principle website.
So
an Edge Principle part of the EdgeMakers digital community, so that principals from around the world can compare experiences adopting EdgeMakers. I think the main thing that a principal can do aside from facilitating EdgeMakers being adopted as a curriculum element, is to find that group of teachers in the school, regardless of their discipline. So it could be biology, it could be literature, it could be history, who are very motivated to teach this because they're very curious about the subject. I mean, if it was me, if there was a teacher development opportunity involving creativity, Steve Jobs, design thinking, you know, digital, the future of digital, all of these sustainability, I would want to do that in 5 seconds. It would take me 5 seconds to say yes, right? And every school probably has at least 10, 15, 20% of teachers. They embrace change, they are curious about a new subject, they want to try something out. And also, we're not asking too much. We're just saying, teacher, one more hour a week and one class a week, right? It's not a big deal. Yeah. Now, there's other things that schools can do. There's co-curricular activities. There's expanded projects. There's thinking about how to reorganize the physical environment of the school. I noticed that you have these I guess these are steel case or chairs. They're on wheels. So they're meant to move around, not to kind of, you know, you're using the new chairs in the traditional way here, but also this is a traditional format. But you know, how do you organize the physical environment for more collaboration? And so the reason that we want to do an EDGE school in Colombia, well, we have a plan to do a fully integrated EDGE school, is because we are in touch with the revolution in personalized education, the whole idea that a student will have their own program that will be continuously updated, that there will be dashboards, new ways of connecting teachers and students and parents, right? And as digital technology and social media become more embedded in the school environment, there's a lot that a principal can do to evaluate how that should be done. So edgeprinciples.com.
Eso se llama edgeprinciples.com.
Yeah, not set up yet, but coming.
Todavía no está establecido, yeah. Pero ya viene pronto.
Yeah.
Buenas tardes.
Sí. Vea, les explico. Lo que pasa es que ese micrófono es para hacer el streaming. Y este es para que escuchen la parte en el español. Pero aquí no había un board, un tablero electrónico para yo conectar lo que ustedes decían. Ese es el inconveniente. Les pedimos mil disculpas. I was explaining to them the problem.
Yeah. Ok, buenas tardes. Mi nombre es William Echavarría Aguilar. Yo soy rector de la institución educativa María Josefa Escobar de Itagüí.
And he is the principal from the María Josefa High School in Itagüí.
En Medellín se inició en los años 70 una innovación Colegio Fontán.
Una innovación
pedagógica en el Colegio Fontán de Medellín.
Okay, there was a school back in the 70s that was called the Fontán School and they started an innovation program back in the 70s.
Mi pregunta es si de pronto la conoce porque cuatro colegios de Itagüí estamos desarrollando esa estrategia innovadora. Y es muy similar a lo que él nos está planteando. Hoy la estrategia se ha desarrollado de una manera más efectiva y eficiente en Bogotá. Por uno de los hijos del fundador Ventura Fontán, quien la ha desarrollado de una manera más efectiva es Julio Fontán.
He lives back there in Bogotá and he has developed this way of doing things back there.
Lo que él nos está planteando es una estrategia, no voy a decir igual, pero sí en un 90%.
90% of the strategy that you have laid out here for us is very similar.
Muy similar. Si no la conoce, lo invitaría a que la conozca para que miremos a ver cómo podemos enriquecer esta estrategia. Yo me comprometo en que le hago el empalme con Julio Fontán para que la conozca y sepa que en Colombia venimos desarrollando estrategias innovadoras donde se desarrolla la autonomía, el liderazgo, la creatividad, la responsabilidad, la innovación, el compromiso.
And all the things that you were mentioning back there, it'll be very interesting.
Okay, it's a deal.
Es un trato.
You know, one thing I forgot to.
Algo que se me olvidó.
So, this is just a demo book.
Este es un libro de
there's a little bit of an introduction to what EdgeMakers is, and then a sample, there's sample lessons, sample teacher materials, and I'll just pass this around. I need this back because it's the only one in Colombia. But you can take a look at it.
Yeah.
But there'll be more in Colombia pretty soon. Okay.
Muy buenas tardes. Yo tengo una pregunta. Es curiosidad que nació en cuanto a la presentación. Porque mencionó que tienen dos maneras de hacer efectivo EdgeMakers. Está la plataforma digital y tienen la otra forma que me imagino que es presencial. Ah, ok. Cuando ya hicieron la implementación en Brasil, tuvieron involucradas escuelas en el Amazonas brasilero. Pues aquí en Colombia también tenemos escuelas en el Amazonas.
We are working with schools without internet, and we've developed the curriculum so it works without the internet.
Okay, perfecto. Y la segunda pregunta muy rápidamente es en cuanto a lo que es el alfabetismo digital de profesores. Alfabetismo digital. Digital literacy for teachers. Digital literacy for teachers. Para profesores que apenas están empezando a conocer pues todo eso en escuelas que están siendo conectadas, si hay una parte de lo que es el training de EdgeMakers que abarca esto, pero para los profesores, no en el currículum de estudiantes.
She wants to know about the teachers because some of the teachers they are not acquainted with the technology and they don't know how to, so they are training them. Mm-hmm. Is there anything with EdgeMakers that involves that field, you know, training the teachers in technology so that way they can work with the kids? Because many of the teachers, they don't know how to drag or do whatever you were showing back there.
Well, we are not a digital literacy curriculum for teachers, but in the teacher training, we train them how to use our digital platform, which is very simple, but which incorporates a lot of the basic elements.
A ver, nosotros no estamos en eso, en el alfabetismo digital, pero dentro del entrenamiento hay una parte que es básica de cómo manejar el sistema y cómo operarlo, porque no es complicado para nada. Entonces sí, sí está allí.
You're welcome.
Bueno, mi pregunta es la siguiente.
My question is the following.
Colombia, este departamento, Antioquia, el mundo está lleno de diferencias. Aquí hay distintas culturas, hay pueblos indígenas, hay, digamos, muchos matices culturales, en formas de ser, de pensar. Ustedes proponen un currículum. ¿Cuál es la idea de mundo, de sociedad que está detrás de ese currículum? ¿Qué puede hacer que un muchacho que estudia acá en Antioquia, que sea indígena, qué es lo que él puede aprender, qué es distinto, qué se espera de él que sea distinto a un muchacho de Brasil, o se espera lo mismo, qué es lo que se quiere que él aprenda y para qué?
A kid from here in Brazil or anywhere else in the world, what is expected of him to learn from those other kids? So because there are different ethnic backgrounds, cultural backgrounds, So you are going to bring everybody together, and how you are going to connect all that people to learn something that they may have in common.
So what's her question, though?
What is la pregunta era? What's the social background behind
edge-makers? ¿Cuál es la idea, digamos, de mundo, de sociedad, que hay detrás de esto? Porque hay un currículum. Hay un currículum que se propone, pero aquí hay, pero hay muchas diferencias.
But there are many differences among all the students that you are.
So, first of all, creativity is human.
Primero que todo, la creatividad es humana, ¿sí?
There are certain basic principles around edge making that are universal.
Que son universales.
But as you point out, there are cultural differences, social differences. But the essence of one of the edge maker skills is about being able to work across cultures and across social class. And creativity comes when you bring diverse people together and something comes out which is unexpected. So the idea that we have a community with lots of different kinds of people is actually a big plus. It's an enabler of our pedagogy. We're not afraid of that. We think it's great. And we expect that kids will. So, in the U.S. right now, and it's not an, I'm not comparing, but in the U.S. right now, teenagers are spending huge amounts of time connected via internet and digital social media. 25% of the relationships they have are with friends not in their same geography and not in their same country. So, you know, they. It's actually something that young people expect. It's not something that they're going to feel is a surprise.
Es una pregunta de parte de. Del Jorge Orrego, que es un rector de Antioquia que nos está viendo a través de la red de liderazgo escolar. Él pregunta cómo enfrenta EdgeMakers los retos que aparecen en las zonas rurales, en las áreas rurales. Si han tenido experiencia en Brasil, en EdgeMakers, en zonas rurales, y qué tipo de estrategias han puesto en marcha con ellas.
Have you had any experience back in Brazil in the rural areas? And what, when you confront any issues, any problems back there, or when you have confronted them, how have you gone about them? I mean, how have you handled the problems in the rural areas? If you are working, of course, in the rural areas.
Right, so just to be clear, we have not launched yet. We are going to launch in January. So therefore, we don't have experience beyond our pilots, which were all done in cities. However, I can imagine that the challenges that the students would take up would have interesting flavor of the rural environment. Security, well-being issues are all different and interesting there. And also that the whole task of having teachers deeply connected to this curriculum would require extra teacher development attention. But I think it should be possible. The rural environment is a gold mine of innovation opportunities.
El ambiente rural es una mina de oro para las oportunidades innovadoras.
So I want to ask you guys a question.
Quiero hacerles una pregunta.
So what is it that you think it will take to make EdgeMakers successful in Colombia? And what do you think the obstacles will be? What are you skeptical about?
You know?
I don't see a lot of smiling faces right now. But maybe you don't smile a lot, I don't know.
who do
It doesn't matter. This nice lady. La señora.
Buenas tardes, soy Luz Elena Álvarez, soy rectora del sector rural.
I am a principal in the rural area.
Se sabe que para innovar se requiere, hasta donde yo conozco y fui capacitada en la metodología por procesos.
We need to
pero esa metodología por procesos lleva también un presupuesto. ¿De dónde saldría ese presupuesto? ¿O si es que va a haber una entidad nacional o internacional que va a jalonar esas innovaciones para ponerlas al servicio del mundo? ¿O si va a haber una, digamos, una ONG que va a estar caminando al pie de los jóvenes para poder propiciar esos descubrimientos y esa innovación? Uno de los obstáculos epistemológicos es el capital.
One of the epistemological problems that we have.
Epistemological problem.
Yeah.
I would call it a financial problem, not an epistemological problem. So let me answer. We don't have our strategy finalized for Colombia. We're talking to people. But it's likely that what will happen is that in the first few years of deployment here in Colombia, the curriculum will be paid for by somebody else. It'll be paid for by companies and by the government in some combination. And after that, the schools have a choice in terms of whether they want to continue or not.
Right.
But we want assistance from the business sector and the government to, it's like turning the wheel, right? We have to get the wheel moving. And then if the schools continue to be interested, they have to make a decision themselves. But if you have a better epistemological strategy, I'm happy to hear it.
Lo último es, ¿cuándo empezamos? Porque algunos ya no vamos a tener mucho tiempo. ¿Cuándo empezamos?
Mire ya la edad. Estoy
ansiosa de
ser. Would you like to
start?
Really? Okay, good. We'd like to start in January.
Queremos empezar en enero.
January.
Ay. ¿Y cómo nos van a vincular a nosotros que estamos interesados?
How are you going to link us, to connect us with the program? How can we get involved with the program?
Well, one thing I notice is there's a email address sheet. Is this an email?
So,
yeah, are you certain it's going around? Okay. So if I can get the contact information, you will be on the list to hear about it.
I think
part of the reason for this meeting is because there are people from the mayor's office, there are people from the government, there are people from foundations here. And if you, as kind of like the customer, say you're interested, then they will say, oh, well, maybe we should pay attention to this, right?
Yeah.
So you have a very, she asked about the role of the principal. You have a very important extra role to play.
Muchas gracias.
But my understanding is that there's a, program for many schools in this area where there are several hours for elective courses. 80,000 students are enrolled in elective course programs. So it would be very easy to get EdgeMakers as one of those elective slots, because we only want 1 hour a week.
Yeah.
Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you, sir.
Yo tengo una pregunta.
She's got a question.
Okay.
Y tengo el micrófono. ¿Cómo pues es posible que los jóvenes que están involucrados en EdgeMakers puedan estar conectados con otros jóvenes también de otras partes del mundo y hacer innovación de forma colaborativa?
¿Cómo es posible?
Que sí es posible, o sea, está planteado para que sea posible.
Is it possible that the kids that get involved here with EdgeMakers get in contact with kids around the world to start creating innovation in a cooperative in an alliance with the rest of the kids. Is that possible?
Well, not only is it possible, that's basic to our approach. If you go to our website now, there's posts from kids from Bali, from Santiago, from Brazil, from New York, and we just got 15 kids from Colombia. They were at the Heroes Fest, and they created videos and blogs, and we're putting those up tomorrow.
Mañana van a estar allí y crearon and varias cosas, varios videos y varios programas en asociación con estos otros
and
adolescentes.
It's very easy for us to, you saw the digital platform. It's easy to say, okay, you're going to have a class in one country and a class in another country work together on the same curriculum or on a project. So that's very basic to our approach.
Para nuestra manera de hacer las cosas, unir esas dos clases.
Should be exciting because we think Edgemakers are a global movement. It's
Porque
for kids everywhere.
Es un movimiento global. Es algo para todo el mundo.
Mi pregunta es, dice usted, señor John, que la estrategia está hecha para ser iniciada en enero.
Para podernos
adherir a esta estrategia, ¿debe hacerse a título particular o está inmersa dentro de alguna política de gobierno?
To be part of this strategy or this new way of doing things, we have to start doing it independently, or this is being promoted by the government. It comes along with a government thing that they want to deploy, or we have to take the initiative on our own.
So right now, I cannot answer that question because we don't. Our strategy is not finished. We're in the middle. In order for us to come to Colombia, there has to be a critical mass, enough demand so that we would spend the money to translate the curriculum and send teacher development people here and blah, 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 right? So ideally, it would be a public-private partnership to fund some number of students, right? Maybe in year one it would be 30,000, 50,000 students, right?
Queremos involucrar entre 30 y 50,000 estudiantes.
You think about it like a scholarship, right? So this, they provide the scholarship.
Esta asociación provee la beca y partiendo de esa beca empezamos a trabajar.
But if you can have, if you can think of another strategy, I'd be very happy to listen. You know, in Brazil, there's 50 private schools that have something like 150,000, 180,000 students. So one approach which we're not doing is just to focus on the rich schools. But that's not so interesting, right? So we're working on our strategy.
Tenemos espacio para tres preguntas más. Entonces, aquí hay una.
We have space room for three more questions.
Three more?
Yeah, there's one back there. Hábleme duro, por favor, que con los años.
Muy buenas tardes para todos. Mi nombre es Francisco de la Barrera, rector de la institución educativa del Rosario del municipio de Itagüí. Vemos con preocupación los resultados de Colombia, las pruebas PISA. Quedamos en el último puesto, puesto
42.
Y precisamente la pregunta mía va orientada
60, I think.
Fue como 69 o
60. 69. Bueno.
And it went down.
Okay, even worse.
La pregunta va orientada a eso. Si esta plataforma o esta estrategia genera un impacto positivo en cuanto al rendimiento o el desempeño en las pruebas censales externas o internas. Okay. Porque resulta que nosotros los rectores nos evalúan una parte, es el rendimiento frente a esas pruebas. Y precisamente que este domingo los muchachos de 11 van a presentar las pruebas a ver 11.
Okay, here he wants to know if this time, this the obtaining of the age is going to increase the performance of the kids when they take this type of test, or if their education is going to be enhanced, because they are assessed, you know, when according to the way kids do within the SAT, if I may call them like that. And this one coming Sunday, the SAT test for the kids from 11th grade, they are going to be taken. They are going to take them.
So the purpose of EdgeMakers is not to get higher scores on PISA.
El propósito de EdgeMakers no es conseguir resultados más altos en las pruebas PISA.
We're not a math course, we're not a science course.
No somos un curso de matemáticas, ni de ciencia, ni nada parecido.
But I think it will help with critical thinking and problem solving, for
sure.
Pero
va a ayudar con la manera en que los jóvenes piensan en la resolución de problemas. Va a ayudar en ese aspecto. Los va a ayudar a pensar de manera crítica.
Besides, I think the PISA scores are important, but not so important. I
Yo
really don't.
Que los, lo de PISA es importante, pero no tan importante.
It's just a game, you know. It's a way of evaluating, creating contests. Like, what's the best company, you know, this year or that year?
Está aquí, está acá, no, no.
I care about the creativity and the entrepreneurship and the, you know, the character of kids, which is harder to measure using PISA scores.
Right. Con estas pruebas PISA.
¿Alguien tiene alguna otra pregunta?
Mi pregunta es para nosotros que estamos acá participando y también para por todos nosotros. Es la innovación tiene muchas aristas.
I like that.
Yeah.
It's good.
Sí. Y la innovación en educación, ¿será que tiene que ver con nuestro paradigma mental? ¿Será que podemos vivir sin pensar que es nuestra responsabilidad y que no está aliada a una herramienta que nos haga innovadores? Esa es mi pregunta. O sea, ¿qué es lo que yo hago para que la herramienta que yo soy genere innovación real en un cambio de paradigma liberador, emancipatorio? ¿Será que la herramienta, porque yo, o sea, mi preocupación es que sigamos pensando que necesitamos una herramienta para hacer innovadores a nuestros jóvenes? O tal vez la principal innovación será nuestra actitud de ser formadores de innovadores y tomar las herramientas como esta como un soporte y no como una salvación.
Well, okay, well, that's not a question, that's a speech. So, I mean, I think that if you looked at the character strengths, what we talked about earlier, this is not tools, this is sort of a fundamental answer to the question of what is education about. So I agree that that the interaction between the student and teacher is fundamentally important. I would not want you to walk away thinking that this is a tool, because it's not a tool. It's a learning environment, a learning system, a curriculum. So this plus a teacher is the sweet spot to me. If you just have a great teacher and no system,
there's nothing.
With, yeah, that's fine, but with no curriculum, there's nothing either.
Pero si no hay un curriculum, tampoco no hay nada.
Okay.
Okay. Buenas tardes.
Oh, one more. Okay. You're the make it a good one. You're the last guy.
Hago una buena pregunta porque usted es el último.
Mi nombre es Hernán Díaz, soy rector de un colegio acá en Medellín.
I am a principal.
el inventor del transistor.
The inventor of the radio transistor.
Oh, yeah.
Los amigos le decían que había inventado el persistor.
Okay.
Porque crear o innovar viene del trabajo. Nadie inventa lo que no está buscando.
Nobody comes up or invents what is not seeking for. If it's not seeking,
o por lo menos está en el área de lo que de trabajo básicamente. Tú preguntabas por los obstáculos. Este tipo de trabajos están amarrados mucho a la motivación que los maestros tienen de aprender. Y nosotros tenemos mucha disposición. El problema es que en este país todo el que quiere salvar el mundo te impone un proyecto obligatorio, no asociado a la expectativa ni al deseo. Entonces, cuando hay iniciativas interesantes que uno se quiere involucrar, la realidad lo aterriza a uno, porque hay que cumplirle a quien dirige un montón de requisitos no definidos por los maestros ni por las instituciones. Normalmente definidos por personas que jamás han estado en un aula de clase. Ese es un obstáculo en este país.
Okay. So, I don't know if I can fix that problem.
Yo no sé si puedo arreglar ese problema.
But if somebody were to teach edge makers,
pero si alguien fuera a enseñar,
they would have freedom within that framework to do some interesting things.
Dentro de ese marco de trabajo para hacer lo que ellos vean que se acomoda más a sus necesidades.
Do we have the email addresses for everybody?
¿Tenemos los correos electrónicos de todos, señores?
Yes? Okay. So would you like me to keep you updated on our progress?
¿Quieren que los mantenga actualizados en los progresos que
estamos
haciendo?
Yes? Okay. All right. So I will make this commitment that when our strategy becomes more clarified, you'll be the first to know if and when EdgeMakers is available in Colombia.
Ustedes van a ser los primeros en enterarse de cómo va a estar disponible EdgeMakers here aquí en Colombia.
And if you have any questions, you can contact me. We also have.
Si tienen alguna pregunta, se pueden contactar conmigo. También tenemos.
We also, actually, I forgot to give you this.
We
put some material in Espanol up on our. So we have a Spanish language part of our website. And this has our web information. So,
hay información en español,
so you can take one of these if you like.
En nuestro sitio web. Y ahí en esos volantes está la información en español de cómo ingresar a nuestra página web.
So I know that you are all here because you're interested in the connection between innovation and education.
Yo sé que todos ustedes están aquí porque están interesados en la conectividad que hay entre la educación y la innovación.
And I think that is really terrific.
Fantástico.
So if I can support that in any way,
si yo puedo ayudarles,
de edge makers
manera,
or no edge makers,
edge makers or sin
just
edge
let
makers,
me know.
Déjenme saber. O no, sí.
Okay.
Gracias. Gracias.